The whale behavior is only half the story if you want to study feeding, right? You also want to look at the context of how much prey there is and where is it located. The way we do that is we've rigged up a system on the back of our boats that actually has these Ecosounders on there that allow us to determine the density and distribution of prey in the water column.
So there's a saying on the California coast called wind to whales. And so every spring we get really, really high winds and that creates upwelling. So those winds basically take the surface waters away from the coast and that's replaced with really nutrient-rich deep water. And so that in turn causes a trophic cascade. All of those rich nutrients will allow the phytoplankton to bloom. It also in turn allows the zooplankton and the krill to bloom. So that's why it's a very seasonal pattern of krill going boom and bust throughout the foraging season for blue whales.
So what the Ecosounder allows us to do is actually determine the density and distribution of prey in the water column. So if you look at this graph, on the vertical axis, you have the depth. On the horizontal axis, you have essentially time or distance. The ship moves across the surface of the water. It's actually mapping. Each one of these vertical lines is one individual ping where it's listening for the return echo. How strongly that signal bounces off of an object in the water tells you how much of it there is and how far away it is. If that click takes longer for it to come back, that means that the object it's bouncing off of is further away. The louder it comes back, the more stuff there is in the water. So what this is then a map of the loudness of the return signal. And the red areas are areas of high intensity. That's an area where you have a lot of stuff in the water column. In this case, it's krill. The white areas mean that, the sound has traveled through there without bouncing off of anything. The blue areas are areas where there's a little bit of stuff in the water, but not so much in there. And so then because we've done these finely calibrated experiments, we can actually tell you how much krill that actually corresponds to.
So we think that krill will migrate deep into the ocean during the day to avoid predation from other predators. But also because they're deep and aggregated, trying to avoid predators, blue whales appear to have evolved foraging strategies that take advantage of that dense patchiness, that depth. Understanding the vital rates of an animal, such as how an animal feeds and its feeding rate, is really fundamental to the conservation and management of these animals. Because blue whales are specialists on a very specific resource, we have very good studies and models that can tell us exactly what the energetic efficiencies are of blue whales, especially how it relates to changes in their food supply.
One of the things that we have to monitor and think about and predict into the future is as the oceans warm, and if they continue to warm at the current rate, how that might affect those oceanographic processes, how that might affect upwelling, which leads to these big blooms, which lead to these krill hotspots. As the ocean warms, those processes might change. And how those are going to be changed is a matter of a big scientific debate. Like, is there going to be increased upwelling, or will warmer surface waters lead to increased stratification that inhibits that cold bottom water, that nutrient-rich bottom water, from coming up to the surface and providing nutrients to the phytoplankton that everything in the ocean thrives on? So how climate change is going to affect these blue whale populations is unknown, but it will probably have a big effect one way or the other.
Blue whales face a number of different threats due to our increasingly urbanized oceans. One specific threat relates to ship strikes. Our tags give us a really detailed view of where these foraging hotspots intersect with the shipping lanes. And if those foraging hotspots change, hopefully in the future we can have a dynamic management solution where we can say, hey, we're predicting that the foraging hotspot is actually going to move west, and perhaps if we just move the shipping lanes a little bit to this side or a little bit to this side, we can significantly decrease the amount of ship strikes that occur. Because blue whales are such tremendous filter feeders, they process vast amounts of the ocean. We think that they might be susceptible to ingesting microplastics, and they might be sentinels for ocean pollution, specifically microplastics.
One of the ways to determine what you're eating is to look at what you're pooping out. And so what we have here is a fecal sample from a blue whale that we collected in Monterey Bay last summer. The reason why it's deep red like that is because they eat krill. Blue whales especially eat only krill, and krill are this dark, you know, deep orange and red color. And what we intend to do is analyze these samples to look for plastics within the fecal sample.
Martin Musculus?
Blue whales are coming back from centuries of exploitation. These new devices have really like opened up a whole new world for studying these animals that we really know so little about.
Every time we learn something, there's actually 10 more questions that pop up. How blue whales migrate across the ocean from their breeding grounds to their feeding grounds, and how they impact the resources that the entire ocean ecosystems rely on is really interesting and important. And that's why we should try to better understand these ocean giants.
Yeah.